Hello friends and welcome to my channel. So friends, today's topic of discussion is the line by line explanation of To the Skylark by William Wordsworth. So friends, it is not To a Skylark by P.B. Shelley, it is To the Skylark by William Wordsworth. And in this session, I'm also going to discuss what is the difference between Shelley's To a Skylark and Wordsworth's To the Skylark. So let's start. So at first, you have to know a few important things about To the Skylark. So the poem's name is To the Skylark and the poet's name is William Wordsworth. The poem was written in 1825. Then it was published in 1827. So here, Wordsworth is influenced by Shelley's poem To a Skylark, which was composed and published in 1820. So here it is clear that William Wordsworth influenced by Shelley's To a Skylark, and after the publication of To a Skylark, Wordsworth wrote or composed To the Skylark. So now we have to know that what is the difference between Shelley's Skylark and Wordsworth's Skylark. Of course, we all know that both the poems' title is different. Shelley's poem's name is To a Skylark and the name of Wordsworth's poem is To the Skylark. So in To a Skylark, Shelley tries to bring out the profundity of the Skylark's knowledge towards the mysteries of life and death. And in To the Skylark, Wordsworth brings out the idea of the Skylark's thought of love and care for its near and dear ones. So now let's start the line by line explanation of To the Skylark. So this poem is divided into three stanzas, stanza 1, stanza 2 and stanza 3. So now at first I'm going to discuss stanza 1. Ethereal minstrel, pilgrim of the sky, dost thou despise the earth where cares abound? Or while the wings aspire, our heart and I both with thy nest upon the dewy ground, thy nest which thou canst drop into at will, those quivering wings composed that music still. So here in this stanza, the poet addresses the skylark as the traveler in the sky and the singer in the upper air. So here the poet actually wants to convey the message that the skylark always travels or flies in the sky and thus it sings song. So friends, here in the first line, there is a phrase ethereal minstrel. So here ethereal means heavenly or a kind of upward regions or upper regions. It possibly means the sky or the heaven. Okay. So here minstrel means medieval singer or musician. So here in this poem, Wordsworth describes or addresses the skylark or compares the skylark to the heavenly or upward singer and the pilgrim means the traveler of the sky. Then in the next line, the poet says that though it soars high in the air, but it doesn't despise the earth which is full of cares. Here despise means disrespect. Okay, so it means that the skylark doesn't despise or disrespect the earth which is full of cares as well as worries. Then in the next lines, the poet wants to say that as the skylark flies high in the sky, but it has its heart as well as his eyes, and they are fixed always on its nest. So here actually Wordsworth humanizes the skylark and invents it with the attributions of a father and husband. So as a father or as a husband always looking at his family or always looking for the welfare of his family. So likewise here the poet questions the skylark whether it is like a father or a husband, also fixed its eyes as well as its heart on the nest below, into which the skylark can drop down whenever the skylark likes by folding its wings and stopping its song. So now we have stanza 2. So here let me inform you one important thing, which is this stanza, means stanza 2, is omitted in some of Wordsworth's works editions, okay? Because Wordsworth himself transferred this stanza to his another poem and that poem's name is The Morning Exercise. But this stanza 2 is also a part of To the Skylark. So now let me read this stanza. To the last point of vision and beyond, mount daring warbler, that love prompted strain, twist thee and thine a never failing bond, thrills not the less the bosom of the plain, yet might thou seem proud privileged to sing, all independent of the leafy spring. Here the poet wants to convey the message that the skylark soars high in the sky to the last point of vision and even beyond, and thus it lost to sight. It means that as it soars high, we cannot able to see the bird, but we can listen to the song of the skylark, because even when it is lost to sight, it keeps on singing. And its song, means the skylark song, is inspired by its love for its mate or young ones that are left in the nest below. And thus it rejoices the plains below. Here it means that as the skylark soars high in the sky, and it also lost to sight, right? And that's why in its upward journey, it still sings, so that the skylark's mate and the young ones, means the skylark's children, can know where is the skylark in the sky and call the skylark down to the nest when they need or as per their need, okay? Then in the last two lines, means yet might thou seem proud privileged to sing all independent of the leafy spring. Here Wordsworth conveys idea that the skylark is a better and a more gifted singer than the other birds, because the other birds sings only in springtime when all the trees are covered with green leaves, but the skylark sings in all seasons to thrill people on earth with joy. So I think that the concept of this stanza is clear. Now we have stanza 3. Leave to the nightingale her shady wood, a privacy of glorious light is thine. Whence thou dost pour upon the world a flood of harmony with instinct more divine. Type of wise who soar but never roam, true to the kindred points of heaven and home. So here in the first four lines, the poet makes a kind of comparison between the skylark and the nightingale. And the poet says that the skylark's song is more melodious than the nightingale's song. Here the poet says that do not worry or do not bother yourself with the thought that the nightingale sings from her shady wood. So as while the nightingale hides itself in the shady wood, the skylark hides itself from the view of the dazzling sunlight because it soars upward in the sky. And thus the poet also compares skylark's song nobler than the nightingale's song. Then in the last two lines, the poet conveys the idea that the skylark is the symbol of the wise men of the earth who soar into the lofty sphere of thought but at the same time attend to the humbler duties of the ordinary life or the common duties of the ordinary life, okay? So thus in a word we can say that in this short poem, Wordsworth compares the skylark with nightingale with other birds and thus brings out the superiority of the skylark and its song. That's it. Thank you so very much for watching, and if you have any queries on any topic of English literature, then please comment me so that I can make a video of it. So bye for now. See you in the next session very soon.